Hi everyone, welcome to Hamska Academy. Hope you all are good and safe, my dear students. So today we'll be learning about the continuation of rise of nationalism in Europe. As I suggest you, please get your textbook, a highlighter, and keep it ready. As you go through the topic, you can underline the key points, and as the topics are done, I am also giving you the notes points which you have to make a note, and compulsorily you have to know from that particular subtopic. So please have your textbook, highlighter, pen, if possible have a notebook also. You yourself can draw the concept maps, which will be easy and convenient for you to learn the topic. Let's get into the topic. So in the previous video, part 1 of rise of nationalism in Europe, we discussed the introduction of the chapter. Then we discussed how the lesson begins with the painting of Frederick Soriot. Then we went on discussing about the difference between a nation state and a modern state. What are the key learnings from the French Revolution, and how did the idea of a nation emerge? So then we learned the notes points. Now, today we are going to learn about the Napoleonic Code. Napoleonic Code got its name as Napoleonic Code because this code is given by Napoleon. This code is given by Napoleon. This code is also known as Civil Code of 1804. This code is also known as Civil Code of 1804. Usually, it is also known as Napoleonic Code. He did away with the privileges which were based on birth. He established equality before the law and secured the right to property. Among the Napoleonic Code or Civil Code of 1804, the first key point is he has given away the privileges which were acquired by birth. If you remember, in grade 9, when we studied about the French Revolution, the society, we called it as old regime. When we called it old regime, because there are certain norms by birth, the nobles, by birth, the clergy, don't pay any tax. Because by birth, they got a privilege that they are exempted from taxes. Similarly, that privileges which you get by birth are taken away by Napoleon Civil Code of 1804. First thing is, he removed the privileges based on birth. Second thing, he established equality before the law and secured the right to property. So, three important points we need to remember here. First, do away with the privileges based on birth. Second, he established equality before law. Earlier, there was no equality. So he brought equality before the law. Now, anybody, whoever is doing any kind of mistake, it can be any person, will be judged and punished on the basis of same law. Same punishment will be awarded for same kind of mistake or crime which is done. No special privileges for anybody who is born in a higher caste, higher privileged segment of the society. Now, he also made right to property as a right. So, he made that right to property is official. So, you will have right to property. He also brought certain administrative divisions. He abolished the feudal system and he freed peasants from serfdom and the manorial dues. So Napoleon brought certain administrative changes. Those are, he abolished the feudal system. According to the feudal system, the peasants have to pay certain amount of their produce to the feudal landlords or the manorial lords. So he has abolished that system completely, and he also freed the peasants. Earlier, the peasants are bound to pay the amounts to the feudal lords. So he freed them from any kind of bondage or slavery which was there because they are in a peasant group. And he also slashed off all the manorial dues. This is the second important step what Napoleon has mentioned in the Civil Code of 1804. Third, he improved the transport and communication system, which were very, very important for any nation's development. So he focused on the improvement of transport and communication system. The businessmen and small producers of goods in particular began to realize that uniform laws, standardized weights and measures, and a common national currency would facilitate the movement or exchange of goods and capital from one region to another. So Napoleon has reduced number of weights and measures into one uniform standard weights and measures. There were different weights or different lengths which are measured, which are different from one place to another place, different taxes which are collected, and then there were different currencies in circulation in the same country. So he reduced all these things to one uniform law, standardized weights and measures, common national currency, which made the trade become easy. You will have one standard weight, one law, and one currency. So similarly, in many places, after looking at Napoleonic Code, in Holland, Switzerland, Brussels, Mainz, Milan, Warsaw, the French armies were welcomed as harbingers of liberty, the torch bearers of liberty. Why did the people of Holland, Switzerland, Brussels, Milan, Warsaw feel that the French armies are the promoters of liberty? Why means, Napoleonic Code first statement, if you observe carefully, they have given away all the privileges based on birth. There are certain families, there are certain people who are controlling by birth, they have certain privileges in these countries. So if Napoleon comes to our country, he will implement the similar kind of rules which he has given in Civil Code of 1804. Then automatically we all will get the equality before law. This made the people to encourage the French armies and welcome the French armies. It became clear that the new administrative arrangements did not go hand in hand with political freedom. Any leader in the world, they do administrative changes, but they never encourage anyone to be as second position to him as a political system. Political system nobody designs, nobody encourages. Nobody encourages anybody to become a leader. Very rare of the situations. That's where the difference comes. So it is a very clear statement that new administrative arrangements, what Napoleon has brought, did not go hand in hand with the political freedom. Why they did not go hand in hand with the political freedom? Because he has brought administrative changes, but politically he did not bring any kind of changes. So he increased taxation, censorship, forced conscription into the French armies required to conquer the rest of the Europe all seemed to outweigh the advantages of administrative changes. So whatever Napoleon tried to do through his civil code of 1804, people welcomed it. People welcomed it in Holland, Switzerland, Brussels, Milan, Warsaw, but he did not do parallel arrangement of leadership, political leadership, and he increased the taxes. He brought control over the press. He forcefully made people to join into the French armies. It's called forced conscription. So this made the French armies to get bad name. Why bad name? Because they initially were welcomed as the torchbearers or the harbingers of liberty, but now there is no liberty. No one is talking about liberty. No one is talking about that. They came here, they started to increase the taxes. Now you cannot talk against that. Similarly, they started to force people to join into the French armies. So people started to think, what is this that is happening to us? So whatever good changes that Napoleon has brought through his civil code of 1804 could not stand for a long time because of the steps taken by the French armies. Increasing of the taxes, censorship, and forced conscription. So these are the things which have outweighed the advantages of administrative changes which are brought by Napoleonic code or civil code of 1804. Children, you need to remember here, while you're writing the answer, you need to use the word Napoleonic code or civil code of 1804, did away with the privileges of birth, equality before law, right to property, simplified administrative divisions, abolished feudal system, and freed the peasants from serfdom and manorial dues. Transport and communications were developed. And similarly, what did away the good activities outweighed the advantages of administrative changes are increased taxation, censorship, and forced conscription into French armies. We need to mention these kind of words: increased taxation, censorship, forced conscription. Don't try to learn the meanings of these words and write that in the answer. Please avoid that. Please write the words which are used in your textbook or in the video so that you get full marks. Because when the CBSE sends us the key, it gives us clearly, please use the keywords. If the keywords are given, please allot full marks. So my dear students, please take the advantage of this, and while you are reading itself, please learn in the terms which are used in the textbook. So notes points. You should know these particular points very clearly. You can see here, equality before law was established in the civil code. If it is asked for 3 marks also, I would request you all to write at least 6 bullet points what we have mentioned on the screen, so that it will be very, very helpful for all of you. So equality before law was established, secured the right to property. Right to property has made as a legal right. Simplified the administrative measures. He brought certain administrative changes, which we discussed. Then he abolished the feudal system, freed the peasants from serfdom, the bondage, and the manorial dues, which were there from before. Guild restrictions were removed. Guild restrictions means trade unions are called as guild associations. So these associations had restrictions from transporting of the particular material or the product from one place to another place. So those restrictions are being removed. And similarly, they worked on improvement of transport and communication system. So Napoleon took away, now the negative point is, Napoleon took away the political freedom. What made Napoleon's code good things, wave away or do away with them, is that he took away the political freedom for the people. As I told you, very rarely the leaders give a system through which another leader can come to that position. Maybe because of insecurity or intolerance, leaders don't allow others to grow, don't design any mechanism to grow. So that is one thing where they took away the political freedom, increased taxes, imposed censorship, and he forced people to join the French armies. So Napoleonic Code or Civil Code of 1804 is a guarantee question in the CBSE board examinations for 3 marks. So please make a note of this one and try to understand this very clearly. See, my only suggestion is take time while you watch the video, go through the textbook, pause the video, look at the points, understand the points, and then go ahead. Do not watch the entire video at a stretch in a casual manner. This is an educational video. So please have your textbooks with you, underline the key points, go through that one, check in the notes points, whether all points you got or not, you understood or not. In any point, if you need more clarity, do not hesitate. Please comment below. We will definitely respond back to you. Hope you all are understanding the Napoleonic Code clearly. The making of nationalism in Europe. Germany, Italy, Switzerland were divided into kingdoms, dukes, and cantons, whose rulers had their autonomous territories. So the regions of Germany, Italy, Switzerland were divided into kingdoms, dukes, and cantons, means different parts, where the rulers had their own autonomous territories. Autonomous territories. What is the meaning of autonomous territories? Autonomous means you are the whole and sole supreme to do within the given territory, within the given boundary. So the autonomous territories are given to the kingdoms, dukes, and cantons, where Germany, Italy, and Switzerland were not as nations. They were divided into parts, and those parts are given to rulers, and these rulers had the autonomous authority over the territories. They did not see themselves as sharing a collective identity or common culture. In Germany, let us say, for example, Germany is divided into 3 or 4 parts. These 4 parts are ruled by different rulers. These 4 rulers, nor the people of these 4 regions, never thought that they all belong to a common culture. They all had a glorious past. They all had a collective identity. They never thought like that. The Habsburg Empire ruled over Austria and Hungary. This is the information what they are giving for us. The Habsburg family used to rule the Austria and Hungary region. Then in Hungary, half of the population spoke Magyar, while the other half spoke a variety of dialects. So here we are trying to understand the differences, or how is the population there. Besides these, there are 3 dominant groups who lived within the boundaries of Hungary or Habsburg Empire. And the only tie, the only bonding of these diverse groups to stay together to a common allegiance to an emperor. So Austria, Hungary were together ruled by Habsburg Empire. The population is mainly the Magyar spoken community, and there are various other dialects. Along with this, we have 3 dominant groups who lived within the boundary. Now, what they want to establish here is there is no common bonding feature or sharing of collective identity in the Austria nor in the Hungary. But what is the one thing which is binding all these people to stay together in diverse groups, diverse language spoken people, is that they all are ruled by 1 emperor. That is the only thing which is making all these people to stay or come under 1 particular knot, that is 1 emperor. Other than that, they don't have any other common ties. aristocracy and the new middle class. The emergence of aristocracy and the new middle class. Socially and politically, a landed aristocracy was the dominant class on the continent. So in Europe, the aristocratic group are basically the owners of large amounts of lands, and they were a dominant force or a group in the continent, in the entire continent. So they can be called with different names in different countries, but basically that particular group is very strong group. The members of this class, the aristocratic class, were by a common way of life that cut across regional divisions. As I mentioned just now, these class people, the aristocratic class people, lived a common way of life where they own lands, they share political power, and these two common aspects across all the countries can be seen. That's what they are mentioning, cut across the regional divisions. You see it in French, you see it in Australia, you see it in Austria, you see it in other places. You have a similar set of people, maybe called with different names, but all these people have a common way of lifestyle. That's where we are calling this as aristocratic class and dominant group in the continent. They often have marriage connections, ties, and this powerful aristocracy was, however, numerically a small group. If you think that they are a very large population, so they emerge powerful, no, you have mistaken. They are a very small group, a very small group. And the growth of the towns and the emergence of commercial classes whose existence was based on the production for the market. So the growth of the towns and the emergence of commercial classes. This is another point we are discussing about how did the new middle class group emerge. So this middle class groups emerged because the towns and the cities started to grow and the commercial activity started to increase. This all happened due to industrialization. Industrialization began in England in the second half of the 18th century. But in France and the parts of German states, it occurred only during the 19th century. So due to industrialization, it paved way for the development of growth of towns and the emergence of commercial classes whose bare existence is based on the production of market. Now, this happened due to industrialization. Industrialization first began in England, and in the second half, it in the 18th century. But in France and in other parts, it occurred by 19th century. During this particular time, a new social group came into being, came into existence. A working class, a middle class made up of industrialists, professionals, and businessmen. So due to industrialization, now the society got into three groups. One who is establishing the industries, one who is working for the industries, and the third one who are doing different kinds of jobs. So it was among the educated, liberal, middle classes that the ideas of national unity and following the abolition of aristocratic privileges gained popularity. So it was during this time, after the classes have emerged, the working class, the middle class, the industrialists, the businessmen, the professionals, these people started to earn money through trade, through business, and they started to make themselves financially strong. It was at this point of time, the educated, the liberals, started to argue about the idea of national unity, and they also want to abolish the aristocratic privileges which they had during that particular time in the society. So in this part, we are learning that aristocracy, what are the features of aristocracy, and how did the new middle class get emerged? So the notes points are this. There was no nation states in Europe because there was no common identity or culture. People residing in different areas spoke different languages. Example, it is given as Hungary. Half of the population spoke Magyar, while the other half spoke variety of dialects in Galicia, and people spoke Polish. Now, aristocracy and the new middle class. Aristocracy is a group of people who own the lands, who spoke French, and they are connected with the ties of marriage, and numerically they are very small group, but they are very powerful and influential across the continent. You find these kind of people in different countries with different names. Similarly, the peasants, the majority of the population are peasants, and these are middle class, a new social class that got emerged in towns and in the commercial classes due to the growth of industrial revolution. So the educated middle class were giving up with the idea that we should have the concept of national identity. At the same way, we should give away with the privileges of aristocratic groups, what privileges they are holding. So children, please make a note, what is the difference between aristocratic group and middle class group? When did these middle classes emerge? How did the middle class emerge? All these points we discussed in this part of the What did the liberal nationalism stand for? In the early 19th century, Europe was closely allied to the ideology of liberalism. The term liberalism derived from a Latin root word called liber. So the word liberalism is taken from a Latin word called liber, meaning free. Freeism. So liberalism stands for freedom of the individuals and equality of all before the law. So basically, liberalism propagated, or liberalism stood for freedom for individuals. Sir, is there no freedom that time? There is freedom. Is there slavery that time? There is slavery that time. Because there is a division among the groups in the society. Certain groups are having extraordinary privileges which they are getting by birth. Certain groups are treated unequally, no proper respect for them. So they want equality also. They are talking about freedom for individuals and equality of all before the law. They want this concept to be accepted by the government. They want this to be taken up by the government. And a constitution with a representative government elected through parliament. So they want parliament, they want constitution, they want the concept of government by consent. They want the government to be established by the consent of the public, by people voting, by people electing them. So right to vote and to get elected was generated exclusively to property owning men. So liberalism stood basically for, the meaning is, we are talking about the origin of the word, that is, it is originating from a Latin word. So you will get one more question. From which language is the basic term liberalism originated? The liber originated. Latin language. What is the word? Liber. What is the meaning of that? Free. So either of these three, language, word, meaning, you will get one more question. And liberalism stood for individual's freedom, equality before law. This is one point. It emphasized on the concept of government. A government should be established by people, by the consent. How do you get the consent? There should be a systematic procedure that has to be established in constitution. Through constitution, you please establish a systematic procedure. Once you establish a systematic procedure, then you give a chance for conducting elections or choosing the government through parliament, not by the king or not by nomination. So once you get this one, you can nominate them and then you give the right to vote. So these are the few points which the word liberal nationalism stands for. So men without property and all women were excluded from political rights. Men without property means poor people. And women, non-propertied men and women, organized opposition movements demanding for equal political rights. So now the liberals started to agitate for equality, equal political rights. The abolition of state-imposed restrictions on the movements of goods and capitals. There was a lot of discrimination among the people. Only the rich men can vote, as you looked in the French society that time. Similarly, there was restriction on the transport of the goods and the capital. So those they wanted to be removed. And if you see an example here, in 1833, if a traveler, a merchant, travels from Hamburg to Nuremberg to sell his goods, he has to pass through 11 custom barriers, means 11 types of toll gates, where he has to pay custom duty of about 5% at each one of them. So 11 places he has to pay 5% of what he is carrying, which means 11 into 5%, 55% of the product what he is carrying is already collected in the form of tax. So he can get less than half what he is carrying. So these are the few obstacles of economic exchanges and growth by the new commercial classes. What are these new commercial classes? Is another name for middle class, who argued for creation of unified economic territory, where you make sure everybody will travel freely, where only one type of tax is collected, not in every place we have a toll gate kind of system where they check them and you have to pay the tax, then only you'll be allowed to move ahead. No. There should be across the country only one tax, unified system, unhindered movement of goods, people and capital. So the liberals started to argue for having unified economic territory, unhindered movement of goods, people and capital. The union abolished tariff barriers and reduced the number of currencies over 30 to 2. So that is a good step. So the union government, means the union system which was there, they have abolished all the tariff barriers, where the people used to pay 11 custom barriers, all were removed, and they reduced the number of currencies in country in the circulation to two currencies, two famous currencies. That's it. Earlier, how many currencies were there? Earlier, there were 30 currencies. 30. 30 currencies were there, which are slashed down to two currencies. So these are the few changes which have come for them. If any notes, if you have to note down here, that is, what is the meaning of the word liberalism? Liberalism stands for freedom of the individuals, equality before law, end of aristocracy or autocratic rules, clerical privileges, and a constitution with a representative government through parliament. In the economic sphere, liberalism stood for freedom of markets and the abolition of state-imposed restrictions on the movement of goods and capitals. Zollverein abolished tariff barriers. Who is this Zollverein? Zollverein is not a person. Zollverein is the trade union. The union what to use the word has abolished. So that is nothing but Zollverein. So you may get one more question. What is Zollverein? Zollverein is a trade union which has abolished the tariff barriers and reduced the number of currencies to 2 from 30. And they also started to work on the network of railways to stimulate mobility across the nation. So these are the key points from liberal nationalism. Please make a note of all the important points. Please underline them in your textbook. If necessary, go back in the video. If you want, I will take you to the back slide. Look at every example clearly. Now that CBSE is asking you logical questions, you need to understand every aspect clearly. Then only we can apply that particular knowledge in cracking the answers. So please go through point by point and understand the concept clearly. The new conservation after 1815. So in 1815, in the Battle of Waterloo, Napoleon got defeated. So after the defeat of Napoleon in 1815, the European governments were driven by the spirit of conservatism. What is conservatism? Conservatism means to get back the pre-revolutionary changes which were in existence before the revolutionary changes have come. So they want all the things to be brought back to the old normalcy, where modernization could in fact strengthen the traditional institutions like monarchy. So modern army, like an efficient bureaucracy, a dynamic economy, abolition of feudalism and serfdom could strengthen the autocratic monarchies of Europe. Why they want to go back means to stabilize their own powers. How do you stabilize the old system with the new changes to develop it to the up-to-date mark, having a well-equipped army, talented and efficient bureaucrats, dynamic economy, good economic progress, reducing the burden of feudalism, serfdom, manorial dues can strengthen the monarchs of Europe. So in 1815, the representatives of the European powers, Britain, Russia, Prussia, and Austria, who collectively defeated Napoleon, met at Vienna to draw up a settlement for Europe. So there should be some guiding principles which might have guided them to decide how to share the victorious part now. Because they were able to defeat Napoleon. I think you all might know that Napoleon is not defeated in a single battle. It is the fourth time they attacked him and fourth time they were able to defeat him. So after a long struggle, they were able to defeat him. So now after they defeated, they want to take the share of that victory. So the Bourbon dynasty, which has been deposed during the French Revolution, was restored to power. So during the French Revolution, the Bourbon dynasty people were removed from power. So they brought back those people back to power. France lost the territories it had annexed under Napoleon. Now French became the country only territory because the other exterior regions were taken away by these powers. German Confederation of 39 states that has been set up by Napoleon was left untouched. The German Confederation, the Union, what has been created by Napoleon was kept untouched, and autocratic did not tolerate criticism and dissent and sought to curb the activities that questioned the legitimacy of an autocratic government. Autocratic government's nature is that they don't tolerate any kind of criticisms or any kind of dissents what they are having. So they want to remove all such kind of authorities or activities which questioned the legitimacy of autocratic government. Coming to the notes points, new conservatism after 1815. What are the guiding principles of the Treaty of Vienna or the conference which happened in 1815 after defeating Napoleon? What are the guiding principles? The guiding principles are restoration, the kingdoms which lost, or the families, the royal families who lost their kingdoms because of Napoleon, has to be restored. Legitimacy, make them more powerful. Compensation, those who have supported this particular group of the kings of Austria, Prussia, Britain, to give them some amount of gifts, so that because they helped to defeat Napoleon. And the last one is balance of power. They don't want any other country to become so powerful, and they don't want this kind of situations to be repeated. So this is a basic guiding principles of the Treaty of Vienna. So as per the treaty, they all want to get back all the old kings back to power. So one such example you can say as Bourbon dynasty, who has been deposed during the French Revolution. They brought them back and they want to strengthen their monarchic style of administration with the modernization. The traditional institutions, they want to strengthen them with the modern facilities like efficient army, bureaucracy, economy, and abolition of feudalism and serfdom. So notes points you can note down. First, what are the guiding principles of the Treaty of Vienna, like restoration, balance of power, compensation, all those things? Then they believe that the institutions can be preserved with changes initiated by Napoleon. They brought back the Bourbon dynasty, which was being restored to power in France. A series of states are being created on the French boundary for preventing, especially for preventing French expansion in future. The German Federation was left untouched. Main intention was to restore back the monarchies that have been overthrown by Napoleon. So these are the key points with the new conservatism of 1815, or what changes have come after 1815. The revolutionaries. During the early years following 1815, the fear of depression drove many liberal nationalists underground. So the fear of depression means the fear of repression drove many liberal nationalists underground, because now the change of power we have seen. So the revolutionaries were targeted and they might attack them. So the revolutionary at this time meant commitment to oppose monarchical forms and to fight for liberty and freedom. So revolutionary meaning here itself, it stands for fighting, opposing the monarchic form and fight for liberty and freedom. So Giuseppe Mazzini, in some books it is Joseph Mazzini, it is Giuseppe Mazzini, was born in Genoa in 1807. He was the one, as you can see his picture on the screen, he became a member of a secret society of Carbonari. Many of them get confused here only. Many of them feel that Giuseppe Mazzini has initiated a secret society called Carbonari. No, he was the one who was a member who joined already existing secret society of Carbonari. So that one point we all need to remember very carefully. He was a member of Dash secret society. Carbonari is the answer. Then he was sent into exile in 1831 for his attempts, what he made to revolutionize or to break a revolt in Lingura region. So he was sent into exile. So what did Mazzini believe? Mazzini always believed that God has intended nations to be natural units of mankind. So he used to feel that the nations have to come naturally. And the secret societies were set up in Germany, France, Switzerland, and Poland. So for this, he gave the starting step. So he has set up the secret societies in Germany, France, Switzerland, and Poland. Looking at his growing popularity and the way he operates the things, Metternich once remarked him as one of the most dangerous enemy of our social order. One who can destroy our order is the revolutionary Giuseppe Mazzini. Giuseppe Mazzini, from very young age, used to dress himself only in black. Why? When they asked him why, he mentioned that my country is in sorrow, so I want to depict this by wearing the black dresses. So he always used to feel about the unification of Italy. He wanted Italy to develop as a nation. That is the reason why he started to attempt revolutions in Lengura. He became a member of a secret organization. As he was sent to exile, then he went to another countries, and there he started the secret societies. So he was one who inspired many people. And he has clear vision that people are born free, so it should be given freedom and liberty for them. At the same time, no king can control different regions. He wants nations to be formed as natural units, what God has given, God has intended. So these are the views of our revolutionary Giuseppe Mazzini, who influenced many people later after him. So the key points about the revolutionary, you can make a note here. He is committed. Who is a revolutionary? That can be a one mark question. Their commitment to oppose the monarchical forms that had been established after the Vienna Congress. So we need to remember this one. So after the Congress of Vienna, they have created a lot of states, and they divided without any combination of the culture or identity, just to share the power. So that need to be remembered. So that went against the interests of the public. He was born, key points, he was born in Genoa in 1807, a member of the secret society of Carbonari. He founded the Young Italy movement in Marseilles and Young Europe in Bern. He believed in the unification of Italy into a republican state. So these are the key points. Now, the age of revolution, 1830-1848. The age of revolution, 1830-1848. As conservative regimes try to consolidate their power, liberalism and nationalism came increasingly associated with revolution. Earlier, revolution was different, liberalism was different, nationalism was different. But as the conservatives, as the kings tried to consolidate their power, all the different viewpoints came together and started to bring revolution in the nations or the regions which are controlled by the kings in Europe. How did liberalism and nationalism get associated with revolution? That is, the conservatives, the existing monarchs, when they divided the kingdom into small parts and they tried to establish their control increasingly on that, then liberalism and nationalism came together closely associated with revolution, and they started to bring revolts in the regions of Italy, Germany, provinces of the Ottoman Empire, Ireland, and Poland. There is a famous saying once remarked by Metternich, that is, when France sneezes, then the rest of the Europe catches cold. If any small activity, any small incident which happens in France, that will automatically spread to other parts of Europe. That's what he is calling here. When France sneezes, the rest of the Europe catches cold. An event that mobilized the nationalist feelings among the educated elite across the Europe was Greek War of Independence. What was that? The Greek War of Independence. Greece, which has been a part of Ottoman Empire since 15th century, now the Greeks living in exile and also from many Western European nations who had sympathy for the some ancient Greek culture, those people have seen this one, that the nationalism has been deprived here. You can see here, in July 1830, the King of France were overthrown and a constitutional monarchy was established. Belgium broke away from United Kingdoms of Netherlands. Greece, which has been a part of Ottoman Empire since the 15th century, struggled for independence, and finally, with the Treaty of Constantinople of 1832, recognized Greece as an independent nation. So, the age of revolutions, why did they come? That it has come because when the conservatives tried to consolidate their power, it is the liberalistic approach, the free approach, what we studied before, nationalism, who share the common culture, common identity, glorious past. All these things came together and they gave their support to revolution by the people. So once they tried to suppress the people's sentiments, that has bounced back. So we can see here, in 1830 July, the King of France has been overthrown and a constitutional monarch was established. Belgium broke away from United Kingdom of Netherlands. Greece, which was part of the Ottoman Empire, is recognized as an independent nation in the Treaty of Constantinople of 1832. The romantic imagination and national feelings. Romantic imagination and national feelings. The development of nationalism did not come about through wars and the territorial expansions. That could be one of the reasons which had made the countries to come together, but the culture has played an important role in creating the idea of the nation. Art, poetry, stories helped the people to express and shape the nationalistic feelings. So the culture played an important role in creating the idea of a nation. How did the culture play? Culture played an important role by their art forms, the drawings, the paintings, the poetry, what they used to communicate vocally, stories, the historical or legend stories which were told about their leaders or their inspiring personalities. Music, every country has their own special way of expressing themselves. Music which were arranged for marriages, arranged for ceremonies, like that. It has shaped the nationalistic feelings through their art forms, poetry, stories, music, etc. So when we look at romanticism, as a word, romanticism means about the nature. The beauty of the nature is described, that is called romanticism. The culture movement, which is sought out to develop a particular form of national sentiment. Now, you need to bring out the national sentiment among the public. So the romantic artists and the poets generally criticized. They have viewpoint that is glorification of reason and science and focused instead on emotions, institutions and mystical feelings. They always criticize the reason and science because through reason and science, you don't get the emotional feelings outside. you may be able to understand why the emotions have come after they have come. But in order to generate the sentiments among the public, we need to focus on emotions. We need to focus on the institutional practices which the countries had and the mystical feeling of belonging to oneness. That can only be developed through the folk songs, folk poetry, folk dances, that the true spirit of the nation. So the romantic imagination and nationalistic feelings are developed, or let us say culture has played a significant role in shaping the nationalistic feelings of the public. How did they shape? Through the art forms, poetry, stories, music, and not the normal music. And the romantic artists always feel that reason and science are important in this century, but from centuries, emotions, institutions, and mystical feelings have driven the public or the humans towards this journey. So it is the folk songs, folk poetry, folk dances, the true spirit of nation. So we have to remember any nation through their folk songs and folk poetry and the traditional way of dancing style, stories, music associated with the culture. So we also have national feelings were kept alive through music and languages. Through their traditional musics and languages, we continue that feeling of nationalism. Karel Karpinský celebrated the national struggles through his operas and music, turning folk dances into polonaise and mazurka into nationalist symbols. So when you take something from the traditional backgrounds, that will be well connected to the public. Language too played an important role in developing the national sentiments. Language itself, when you speak in the regional language or when you speak in the own language, we feel very happy and feel that we all belong to one group, connected. The Russian language was imposed everywhere. Now, why did these people get this feeling? Because the Russian language has been imposed on them. So they want to speak in their own language. So many members of the clergy in Poland began to use language as a weapon to show their resistance. So they're saying clear no to the Russian language. And they're resisting it. How they're resisting it? They're not fighting there. They're using their own language and they're trying to resist the thing which has been imposed against them, that is to speak in Russian language. But we will not speak in Russian language. We will speak in our own language, Polish language. Like that, they were resisting it. As a result, large number of priests and bishops were put in jail and sent to Siberia by the Russian authorities as a punishment for their refusal to preach in Russian language, which means a clear indication that whenever there is a resistance, definitely that will be followed by some step taken by the authoritative people. So here you can see one example. The number of priests and bishops were religious heads. They were asked to communicate in Russian language, but they refused to do so. So they were punished and they were sent to jails. So the notes making points are here: romantic imagination and national feelings, the cultural movement which sought to develop a particular form of national sentiments has been criticized, the glorification of reason and science, but they focused on emotions, intuitions, and mystical feelings. German philosopher John Gottfried Herder tried to discover the culture among the common people. He did a study on this. He went to people, he collected the identities which the common people have about the culture, that is the folk songs, folk poetry, and folk dances. This is the romantic imagination and national feelings. How do we create or make people aware that they all belong to one particular culture? That is through their traditional institutions, mystical feelings, and traditional dances which the common people do in different situations.